Starting with this module, we will begin exploring EMS system communications. This particular module explores components of EMS communication systems in general. Once completed with this module, you should be able to identify EMS communication system components and describe proper radio communications between EMS providers and dispatch. Public safety communications have evolved considerably over the years and now include not only portable radios and cellular phones, but internet-connected devices, wireless video chat technologies, and even satellite-based systems. Despite these various communication options, the most common method of communication for emergency service agencies continues to be radio-based systems. In short, radio systems communicate through radio waves, which is a type of electromagnetic radiation that can be encoded to carry various types of information or data. These radio waves oscillate at different frequencies. When isolated, a radio will receive or transmit on a specific radio frequency. Given the amount of wireless data and information that is transmitted on a routine basis using radio frequencies, the importance of the Federal Communications Commission, FCC, cannot be understated. The FCC is the nationwide administrative agency that assigns radio frequencies to various users, such as television stations, public-use radios like CB or citizen band radios in vehicles and trucks, or portable radios that a family may take with them when camping, and emergency response agencies. Unfortunately, radio frequencies are a finite commodity, and as a result, they are heavily regulated to ensure those who are rightfully using a frequency may do so without fear of interference from other unauthorized users. As a matter of fact, the FCC updated its standards in 2013 to require what is known as narrowband transmissions to allow more agencies to use limited radio frequencies and, as a result, made older 25 kHz technology radios obsolete and unusable from that point forward. As a paramedic, you do not necessarily need to know the ins and outs of how radio frequencies and systems work, but you will need to know how to use them effectively and appropriately, as well as what to do if a primary communication mechanism is not functioning, which can happen in areas where interference or shielding can stop wireless communications, or in remote areas not adequately covered by radio or cell towers. Because radio communications are still prevalent for emergency service agency communications between dispatch, apparatus, and individual units, we will first identify the components of a typical radio communication system. The first and most important physical piece of a robust and reliable radio communication system is the base station. A base station is located at a fixed location and utilizes antennas, geography, by ideally being located in a high area, and significant power to extend the range of the base station. These base stations are typically configured to operate on multiple frequencies and bands. Some may incorporate repeaters to further extend their range, and digital capabilities are being introduced and upgraded all the time to improve communications. More on that in just a bit. Mobile radios are the next component of a typical emergency response agency's communication system. These radios are vehicle-mounted and transmit at a lower wattage than base stations. A mobile radio may use 20 to 50 watts of power, while a base station, by comparison, may be in excess of 275 watts. Given this reduced wattage, a mobile radio typically has a transmission range of 10 to 15 miles over what would be considered average terrain. Individual portable radios are the last major component of a comprehensive radio communications system. These are battery-powered, handheld devices carried by EMS providers with a power rating of 1 to 5 watts, which limits their range considerably when compared to a base station or an apparatus-mounted mobile radio. Coverage of 3 to 5 miles is common for these types of radios. To extend the physical coverage of a radio communication system, many agencies utilize repeaters, which receive and retransmit signals through a specialized base station transceiver designed for that purpose. Repeaters are often located strategically throughout a response area to provide broad coverage of the radio system and commonly use tall buildings, water towers, or geographic features like elevated hills or mountains to extend the reach of their antennas. Many agencies have switched over to digital radio systems that digitize the audio before transmitting it in a digital form. These systems are often trunked, which allows the system to pool several frequencies to expand the capabilities of the system and accommodate multiple agencies and users at one time. Given the digital nature of the transmissions, these systems are also able to provide secure communications between the sender and receiver. In the event a radio is lost or stolen, those devices can even be remotely deactivated or denied further access to the system. Additional benefits of such integrated systems is the ability to design for multi-agency interoperability, which allows different agencies across different disciplines to communicate easier than previously possible using shared or earmarked channels within those systems. Given broad cellular tower coverage in areas that are reasonably populated, cellular telephones have also become commonplace in EMS, especially in communications between the providers in the field and medical direction or a receiving facility. These devices can often be paired with other medical equipment, such as 12-lead EKGs, to transmit data. The conversations are secure, and given improved bandwidth and transmission speeds, live, real-time video communications with audio are even possible. As a matter of fact, in 2012, Congress authorized the Department of Commerce to create an independent authority called FirstNet, short for the First Responder Network Authority, to develop, build, and operate a nationwide broadband network for first response agencies. This network has since been developed by AT&T and is available for use by public safety agencies across the country. As a paramedic, you will be in routine contact with dispatch, other agency resources, and other agencies and healthcare professionals, including other public service agencies, as well as your medical director and staff at a receiving facility for your patient, such as a hospital emergency department. Generally speaking, it is important to ensure your communications with these various parties are clear and professional. While many modes of radio or other communication are now secure, that is not always the case, and even if it is, you have no idea who is on the other end of that radio or if there are other people within earshot of that receiving radio or a cell phone or landline phone that has been placed into speakerphone mode. Be sure to keep that in mind, as unprofessional communications across a radio, cell phone, or landline phone definitely have the potential to create problems for you as an EMS provider. Essentially, every agency has its own policies and procedures on radio use and proper communications. For that reason, we will not delve too deeply into what constitutes a proper communication between EMS providers and dispatch or another unit or agency. What we will do, however, is discuss some broad generalities that are common across most systems as far as routine communications are concerned. An EMS response often begins with receiving a dispatch. This could be through the use of an in-station alerting system, the use of pagers, monitoring a radio, or even the use of a smartphone or computerized program or application that notifies responders of a need for their services. Regardless of how the initial dispatch is received by the EMS crew, they must acknowledge receipt of the call. This typically entails repeating the information received from dispatch to ensure the responding crew has the correct information, including the location to which they will be responding. The responders should also notify dispatch when they are en route to the scene, and in systems that use response priorities, the crew should indicate whether or not they are responding on an emergent basis with lights and siren activated. If response to the scene is delayed, as may happen if the ambulance encounters a train, dispatch is often notified. In some systems, such a delay may even prompt the dispatch of another unit that may be able to reach the destination quicker. If the response is halted entirely, as could occur if the ambulance is involved in an accident, dispatch needs to know so that another unit may be sent or mutual aid requested from another EMS agency. Once the unit arrives on scene, dispatch should be notified. Some agencies even contact dispatch to timestamp when patient contact is initiated by the EMS crew, as that time could be different from when the EMS unit simply arrives on scene. When EMS departs the scene, the unit should notify dispatch of its status. Is the unit transporting a patient? If so, what is the destination? If the EMS crew is not transporting, are they back in service and available for another call, or must they remain out of service for some reason? This communication with dispatch is important, as many dispatch centers are required to contact EMS units that have been on scene for a prolonged period of time without any additional communication with dispatch. This practice helps ensure patients are transported in a timely fashion without providers spending unnecessary time on scene, while also helping to ensure EMS personnel are safe. If an EMS crew responds to a scene and dispatch does not hear from them within a specific period of time and cannot raise the crew on the radio, something could have potentially happened to the crew, and physical follow-up from another unit or law enforcement may be requested. If the crew is transporting a patient, dispatch should be notified when the crew arrives at the receiving facility or, in the case of an intercept with another ambulance or an air medical service, the rendezvous point. Lastly, the crew needs to notify dispatch when they are back in service. That may occur after patient transfer to the receiving hospital, but before the crew actually physically leaves the hospital. On the other hand, it may not be until after the crew returns to the station to restock the ambulance. Regardless of when the ambulance and crew is ready to respond to another call for service, dispatch must be notified. As a caveat to this information, there was a day in which EMS and other public service agencies used 10 codes to communicate with dispatch and each other. After 9/11 and the implementation of the National Incident Management System, however, the use of clear text has become the standard for radio and other communications by emergency response providers. The biggest problems with 10 codes were that they were not standardized, and the same 10 code could mean two very different things depending on the agency that used it, and that it also required responders to memorize the codes, which often presented problems for those who may be on multiple agencies that use different 10 code definitions. Emergency response and mitigation is a critical activity, and it is important for communications between emergency responders to be crystal clear and understandable, especially on incidents where multiple agencies are involved. The use of clear text communication reduces the potential for communication errors that may occur when 10 codes are employed. With this overview information in mind, you should now be able to identify EMS communication system components and describe proper radio communications between EMS providers and dispatch. Subsequent modules will delve into other aspects of EMS system communication. Remember as well that these principles are merely a restatement of what you should have already learned in your initial EMT education and training. These elements do not change simply because you are a paramedic. Remember what you have previously learned, apply your experience within your agency accordingly, and ensure your radio or other communications are clear, correct, appropriate, and professional at all times. This presentation was prepared by Waukesha County Technical College in Pewaukee, Wisconsin, and is distributed with an attribution, non-commercial, share-alike 4.0 International Creative Commons license. Copyright 2019 Waukesha County Technical College. For information on WCTC's numerous fire and EMS educational offerings, please visit us online at wctc.edu.